Good morning. Welcome to the National World War I Museum and Memorial. My name is Laura Vogt. I'm the Curator of Education, and truly it is my honor to welcome you all here in this Memorial Day weekend. It is a great weekend filled with activities, so do continue to look at that activity sheet or talk to some of our volunteers who are outside and find out some of the other things that are going on today. But you have joined us for what is one of my favorite activities of the entire weekend, which is our conversation with Linda Granfield. She is a, I want to say that she's Canadian, but she's also got a great Boston accent, so you're going to think that I'm a liar at the same time. But she has written over 30 books, is an award-winning author, including books on the First and Second World Wars, the Korean War, and one of my favorites that I've seen recently as far as children books are concerned, and it's about the war in Afghanistan. With that, let me introduce Linda Granfield.
Thank you. Good morning. Always have to check. Good morning. Good morning. So it's nice to see you. I'm going to try to stay where I can see your faces because I very much react to what I see on your faces. So don't look too bored because if you look really bored, then I'm in trouble. I won't be able to proceed. Yes, I grew up in Boston and a family very much dedicated to military service. My dad was one of five brothers who served in World War II. He had another brother who served in Korea. I have two career U.S. Army brothers myself who just retired. And I still have a sister-in-law who's a colonel and I understand is being given a huge award by the U.S. government in the next few weeks for statesmanship in Afghanistan. So yay, we're very proud of her. And there's another generation that's now serving, the kid, those nieces and nephews. So I'm sure many of you come to this museum with a history in your own family of service and then your own remembrance of those who served. So it's a great honor to be back here. I was telling somebody that, yes, I married my Canadian, I met in graduate school, and I've spent 40 years learning Canadian history as an immigrant, which is kind of bringing the family in a circle because two grandparents were from Ireland, but two grandparents were also from New Brunswick, Canada. So here we go with a big circle of immigration going on. One of the people I met in studying Canadian history and World War I in particular was John McCrae. Some of you were here Thursday evening. I don't want you to fear when you see the first few slides or some of what you saw that, oh no, here we go, same talk. No, it isn't. It's totally different. I did rearrange it expecting more young people. So it doesn't mean you're not going to enjoy it, because I sincerely hope you will. At the end, we'll have time for questions. If anyone has a question about a picture they've seen. I was last at the museum in 2003, and I picked up this little brochure because I had seen this exhibition here called Candy, Coffee, and a Smile, Union Station's World War I Canteen, which I still can remember the setup of. The exhibition was so great. But on the back, it said the future of the Liberty Memorial Museum, and it had a drawing of the proposed new museum, which we're now sitting in. So it's sort of nice to see what they foresaw for the future of this museum, and here it all is for us to enjoy on a special weekend. So in those 40 years, this is the first time I've been back for Memorial Day, and it's really, really special. So I thank them for having me. Because it is Memorial Day weekend, and because we are talking about the Flanders Fields poet, I thought, as I did the other evening, I'd like to read the poem. Sometimes I forget, and by the end, get so caught up in topics. But I think it's an appropriate start. In Flanders Fields, the poppies blow between the crosses, row on row, that mark our place. And in the sky, the larks, still bravely singing, fly scarce heard amid the guns below. We are the dead. Short days ago, we lived, felt dawn, saw sunset glow, loved, and were loved. And now we lie in Flanders Fields. Take up our quarrel with the foe to you. From failing hands, we throw the torch. Be yours to hold it high. If ye break faith with us who die, we shall not sleep, though poppies grow in Flanders fields. So that poem, on May 3rd of this month, we acknowledged the 100th anniversary of that piece of poetry. And I want to show you a bit about John McCrae. And I also want to share for young people, I mean, I think they're a little young, but some people ask about connections in history. And this is one of the connections. 10-cent plastic noisemaker for birthday party loot bags or gift bags. And I got that because my kids had this one, which was made by a farmer who made children's toys. So I thought, oh, mini version. I wanted this for my kids because I had this one, which is marked, dated 1927, and that was my mom's. And that one I kept because I had this one. Now, when you go into school, and I've seen about a million kids in schools, the minute you pull this one out, you know what happens. So then I can say, oh, I guess you don't want to hear it. And you know what the answer is. Yeah, yeah, do it, do it, do it. Now, all the others are toys. In fact, that little tiny one probably gets thrown into the kitchen trash right away because it's when the party's over. All the others are toys, but I'm sure if any of you know about the First World War, it's the first war where gas was used as a weapon against people. This was the gas alarm. It is 100 years old. And this is what the man on watch would watch for, that green or yellow gas coming across the landscape, and sound the alarm, at which time, because we didn't have gas masks, the soldiers were supposed to pee into their handkerchief and hold it over their face in order to live. You can imagine how grossed out kids are about that one. But there's always a kid in like grade 8 that has figured out something about science and he knows it will save your life. You'll still have damaged lungs, but it will save your life. So the fact that the soldiers who then had metal after the war, wasn't being kept for the war, a lot of these tin toys, the tops and these, were made. So we associate these with New Year's Eve, but when you think about it, we have the Roaring 20s after the First World War. And that's, if you get home from that war, it's supposed to go for 4 months, and it lasts for 4 years, and now they're talking about it could have gone on for two more. I've also recently seen some things about Germany had recruited 12-year-old girls that were in the army. So they were so running out of manpower. The thought of two more years of that war is just very upsetting to think. But party, have a good time, raise those skirts, make that jazz, change the music, invent cocktails, anything to celebrate life. So the toys have descended from an important piece of the war. So this is in Flanders Fields. I'm sure a lot of people here know that poem. In the middle we have, I'm lucky I have a pointer, I have to learn to use it. The Isser Canal, which is on the side of that Isser Canal, is where McCrae actually wrote in Flanders Fields. And we have a nice picture of John McCrae wearing his Homburg when he's in his 20s. And of course, the poppy. I collect poppies. I have about 130 from dating from 1921 down to current times. And they're from different countries. I'm still searching for one from France from the 1920s. But one of these days, I'll find one. Briefly, for those who, on Thursday, I should ask the people from Thursday if they want to give this part of the talk. Any volunteers? No? Oh, okay. All right, in Guelph, Ontario, I live in Toronto, Ontario, so about an hour's drive west, 40 minutes, if it's not bad traffic, I can get to Guelph and see the birthplace of John McCrae. He was born in November 1872. Here we have his parents, David, who was a cattle breeder. He used to have back and forth trips into the United States and over to England and Scotland to sell his cattle or to bring over new stock. And then his wife, Janet, well-read, very Presbyterian family. Kids, church meant a lot in this family. And then we have the children. Older brother, Tom, who also went on to become a doctor. He's, 2 years older than John. That's the cousin, Jeannie. And Jeannie in this family shot has the important job of holding up John, the baby who's wearing a dress, which you can imagine how that goes over in schools. They're like, it's not a boy, he's wearing a dress. And we discussed diaper access in the old days. So I love those striped stockings. More pictures from his childhood. It's amazing how someone can become so famous for this piece of poetry, but it's hard to find pictures of him. And so we're lucky we have the number we do for his childhood. Again, here he is with his wearing his baby dress. There were pictures. That dress was worn by all the kids in the family. There he is when he's moved into the short pants. And this is how your mom would order those pants through the mail order catalog. A place like Guelph would have a mercantile store, but they wouldn't really have access. They'd have to get a lot of things from Toronto. The grandparents lived in this house, Jane Field, named after the mom, who liked to be called Jane. And that house is privately owned. As you can see, all the farm fields around it have been filled in with subdivision. But that house still has the original etching over the door of Jane Field, the name of the house, and all the woodwork. It's a designated house, even though it's privately owned. So it's really nice that there's one building, at least, besides the birthplace, where you can go and you know that that family lived there. Here's when they're getting older. Mom, Tom, the blue mark is in the picture is always marking John. So there's John. And they have a little sister named Jill. Tom married, you'll see later, this picture I have to cut out for this one, but Tom married and he had no children. John never married, there are no children. So it's only through the little sister, Jill, that we have descendants of John McCrae's family. The clan McCrae is huge. So if you are a McCrae, you are part of the same clan. In that way, you're related. I went on to university. This picture, we've just had people. This is what happens. You go through the stuff in your house, and you find a picture, and then you notify a museum. And this is what happens a lot of times. And this is how this picture was found. This is Alice Jane McCrae, different spelling McCrae, not part of his immediate family. And she was his first crush when he was in university. And her family had that picture, and they had a copy and made and sent it to the Birthplace Museum in Guelph. There he is at university with his brother and John, the University of Toronto. The buildings are still there. A nice, fun picture of him with the watermelon. It's like everyone expects you to have really serious pictures, but it's nice to have these playful pictures out of his life. We all have those in our scrapbook of being a goof or doing something fun. That's his graduation picture from the university. He stayed on to get a medical degree. He belonged to a fraternity house. That's the fraternity house. Looks like a castle. He also belonged to the varsity glee club. Right after this picture was taken on the back of the caboose on the train, that whole group got into trouble for misdemeanors in one of the towns, and they were all sent back to the university in disgrace. We don't know exactly what they did, but they got into trouble. A page from his scrapbooks. Scrapbooks people keep. If you don't want people to figure you out 100 years from now, get rid of your scrapbooks. Because you can tell a whole lot about somebody from what's in the scrapbook. He loved poetry. He had snippets from magazines. He liked adventure stories, the stories in the boys' magazines. He loved the sea. He liked pretty girls. And we discussed this the other night, that the pretty girl pictures, the boys' magazines knew that the only way they could get pretty girl pictures in was going back into history, because then it was legitimate. It wasn't disgusting. Like, it would be, if a girl in 1890s was dressed like this on the street, she would have been one kind of girl and no good person would talk to her. And these are still the days when you never saw your mother's hair wet. Like, if she shampooed, she wore a cap so that you would not see her long hair all wet hanging down. She'd wear the cap till her hair dried. You'd never saw your mother's bare feet, ever. She would not leave her bedroom without her shoes on. So how do they give this titillation to the young men? They go back to ancient Greece, in Rome, and they do historical drawings. They make the faces like the women of 1890s, but they have, this one, her hair's up, but a lot of them, they'll have Spanish senorita, and her hair's all down, and her shoulders showing, and it's just like, oh, you're just learning history. It's okay. So it's a fun part of going through, but watch out what you put in your scrapbooks. And then as part of medical school, they all had to, third year students had to deliver babies. They had to assist at six births. And there he, there's John with a baby. It's the only picture we know of him with a baby. He goes off to the war in South Africa in 1900. He was a gifted artist. This is a drawing he did of the ship they took out of Halifax Harbor over to South Africa. He was with the artillery. So when you see the artillery pieces in this museum, it's just the impact of how huge those pieces are when you tend to see a lot of photos like this. To be standing next to it and imagine the sound is pretty powerful. There he is in uniform. He then went on, when he came back from the war, he went on to work as a doctor and a teaching physician at the university in Montreal, which is McGill University. The buildings that he taught in are still there. This is a plaque from his private practice. He also went every Wednesday on the train to the University of Vermont, and he taught medical students there. And then we have, here he is, teaching new doctors in a children's clinic. And this is the Royal Alexander Hospital, which is just being closed now. They're moving patients. Last month they began the move into new facilities, and they're hoping that will be kept as a condo building. But it's sort of up for grabs. In 1914, he joins the war. They tell him he's too old to be with the artillery again because he's over 40, and so he has sort of a hissy fit, and his friends in the military say, you can come in as a brigade surgeon. So he goes in as a doctor. Doctors usually did not carry weapons. He insisted because he saw himself as a soldier first, and so his pistol is now in the Canadian War Museum in Ottawa. If you ever get there, it's an incredible new museum, about five years old, and it's nice to be in this one and then juxtapose it with a British Army museum, which has an element of U.S. history in it too. That's his sign-up papers. That's the picture most people know of him, is this lower, the oval. But this one just recently came to light, so it's kind of nice to have something different, because you get to, you go to one picture all the time. Now we have the poem in Flanders Fields because of that gas alarm, that battle, the Second Battle of Ypres in Belgium in April 1915. That's Ypres before the war, and Ypres, the cloth hall after. And this is all rebuilt. It was rebuilt after the war. It was partially destroyed again in World War II. It was rebuilt again. It's a lovely plaza where people walk from there. Has anyone been to Ypres? And then you go to the Menin Gate, the walk from town. It's wonderful. So it's because of the death of Alexis Hannum Helmer that we have in Flanders Fields. And here he is in the group. And there's McCrae, and this is in England before they went, the Bear Inn, as you can see up here. On the morning of May 2nd, a shell exploded at the feet of Helmer and another soldier. McCrae wrote home about collecting the pieces of Helmer and burying him. He was the officiating officer at the burial, and the next morning he wrote in Flanders Fields. Now, right away, he had had different poems published, but he had rejections. He wrote the poem at Essex Farm Dressing Station. This is what it looked like. These doors are still there. That's what it looks like now. Inside there is where McCrae and other doctors attempted to save lives and decided who was going to be sent back to England. He sent off the poem. It was rejected the first time. The second time, it was printed in Punch magazine down on the left-hand corner without his name. But that poem was immediately found and memorized. And this is a mixed magazine. Punch magazine has a lot of comic art, a lot of jokes, the stuff here about jokes about dentists on the same page. So quite a selection. The Poppy before he wrote that poem was used in this way, fine art use. This is John Singer Sargent's painting of poppies. And as you can see, greeting cards. This is the height of the postcard. Millions of postcards, actually a lot of them printed in Germany because Germany had really good lithography and the whole world collected German postcards. That was the change after the war. But you can see they're for different holidays. After 1915, that's General Haig over with the Haig poppy selling. But we have Flanders poppies, because of that poem, get known all around the world. So seed companies, here's one, look where it's from. Carthage, Missouri. The seed catalogs, they start calling them Flanders poppies because in their sales pitch, and sometimes these also were used for campaigns, like we'll sell seeds. In fact, they just had a campaign with poppy seeds in Canada to create the first statue of John McCrae that is in Canada, and you'll see a picture at the end. These are from the collection I have. So you see this one's 1921 Decoration Day. So some are British, you can see, so that's cotton fabric, that's crepe paper, that's silk. This one's paper, that one's silk. So all different materials, fuzzy ones, you'll see some other pictures as part of the collection I've used for illustration. The other remembrance item is rosemary. And so in Australia, we just had Anzac Day. They sell pieces of rosemary like we eat. Its meaning since ancient Greek times has been remembrance. So here's a rosemary that's for remembrance, postcard from the period. Now the other jobs, this is where the ones were Thursday, now it's all new, so if you're taking notes, it's all new notes. I wanted to share different topics, and one of them is nursing sisters, which is the British, the United Kingdom form of calling them the nursing sisters, where we just say nurses. But the whole attitude towards having women on the battlefield and in the forces is something that has intrigued me, where we have reporters or nursing sisters, nurses. The women also rode on motorcycle groups. They also, for delivering messages. They also went with the Hello Girls. I don't know if you know about them, where they were hired from private schools in the States, if they knew French from their private school education. They were hired, they actually had a uniform. They went over to France and they were doing translations of telephone calls that would come in for the army. And they were called the Hello Girls. And there's a famous poster of the Hello Girls. This, the American Red Cross, also with the Salvation Army. What I found recently, and I hadn't known about, was the fact that we were running out of, in 4 years of the war going on in the world, bandages. They ran out of bandages. They used two things in place of rag bandages when they ran out. One was crepe paper. I don't know if you know this. Denison started making these rolls of crepe paper that were used as bandages. All sanitary paper, keeping things as clean as possible. The other thing was sphagnum moss, and kids used to be sent out to collect sphagnum moss to dry, and then it was bundled up and sent over, and if you had an open wound, they would actually put a piece of moss on it to keep bacteria out, and then they could use a dirtier piece of used cloth on top of that, but you were guaranteed to keep that the germs out. As far as stats, more soldiers died from bacteria than died from being shot on the battlefield. It was the bacteria that got them, because you don't have penicillin, there's very little to use. They have early x-rays, but pretty limited in terms of treatment of war wounds. Reading, the reading to soldiers. The big thing I'm working on now is donuts. The donut in First World War is huge. There are some pictures upstairs in the display about this, but the Salvation Army, though they called them the Donut Lassies as a result of this, they wanted to bring a bit of home as part of their mission over there. But what happened is, because of their lack of ingredients, they discovered that they could make donuts. And they went from twist, like cruller kind of donut to the round donut, to the point where soldiers actually did line up. And I just upstairs in the archives down, I think it's on this floor here, found something that corroborated what I'd seen, which is soldiers would stand for 5 hours to get a donut in the First World War. And they'd take a twig and they'd go up to the cauldron. They wouldn't even wait till they had them out like that. They would go up and they would pull it up out of the oil and then walk away with it. So that thing of soldiers, they're not always fighting. They sit around and wait. Well, part of their waiting, they spent the time waiting for the donuts. So it's a huge story. We have songs about it. Joke cartoon postcards, again, huge postcards. These are two of the posters that were done. And then Crisco would use that recipe, wartime donuts, that would be in the women's magazines. So all the moms at home who were getting letters from their sons about donuts, that whole donut thing carried over. Now, World War II, where my dad and my uncle served, I was talking to one of my uncles about the donuts, and he was expressing how that meant home, that represented home. And I understand that, and I'm trying to verify this, that the fellow who started Dunkin' Donuts was actually a veteran who had had donuts overseas and created that chain. For Canada, we had it continue into the war in Afghanistan, because if anyone's traveled in Canada, you know Tim Hortons is the big donut chain. Tim Hortons actually hired civilians to go over to Afghanistan and set up booths to give away donuts to the Canadian soldiers. So this is like a perpetual theme at wartime, is how are you gonna bring a bit of home to people who are so far from home? Now we can Skype and email, the soldiers can Skype and email family, but these are the days when you can't, and when you have a leave, you're not gonna go home. Really important stuff. So that's what I'm working on now. So I thought if there are any young people here, they might like to know food is involved. Other things that were aimed at kids. Women's magazines would have these pages of paper dolls that you see here. So it's everything from, you know, his wedding suit to uniform and his kit. This is really neat because you wouldn't expect to look as for history on a paper doll page. But actually, if you see those mess kits upstairs, there's one hanging, a U.S. soldier's mess kit, and it's got all the pieces. And you think, what do they care when they're drawing this, that they would have that accurate? But they did. They cared. It's accurate. I like the dog. You always have to have a dog on the paper doll pages. Then you'd have, like, this sort of thing on the postcards where you have who's... You know, he's representing the British soldier. This is the enemy. And then he has to protect the little French girl. So this gets perpetuated, the Allies versus the enemy, on the children's postcards. The other thing is, it also creates highly unrealistic expectations. A boy who's reading this book is seeing something that can't happen. If you had a shell explode that close to you, we can all imagine what the real picture would have looked like. But in the literature that comes out at the time, there's a big push to get boys interested in signing up as soon as they're the right age. And it worked. Because every time the numbers would start fluctuating to weaken the forces, something would come out that would bring that number up again. Upstairs, you'll also see a miniature uniform. And these were made, someone asked me about these. I can't be 100% sure, but I think miniature uniforms were actually kept at photography studios. And so you could take your child in and they could try put it on and wear it in the picture in the actual studio setup. And other people made them. It's not like Halloween costumes. It's like, you have someone in the service, so you're gonna make them mini outfits so they can be your little soldier type of thing. That's what we see here. Also, here's a primer for school. So we're not even like the age boy that would read this. How well these boys march. Do you see Roy's flag? Jim has a drum and a toy gun. Roy will hoist his flag and Jim will beat the drum. They enjoy making a noise. So you have the military setting again. Marching is not just kids having a little parade. It all becomes heavy with symbols of what's going on in the world. Of course, here we have Moena Bell, Michael, the poppy lady. I put the cover of this book that came out a couple of years ago, Barbara Elizabeth Walsh. Her dad actually met Moena Bell, Michael, and all through his life, he just passed away a couple of years ago. He lived to see the book come out, which was really nice for her. He spoke about meeting her and speaking with her. She was from the American South, but she happened to be, 2 days before the armistice, she happened to be in New York City at a YWCA meeting, and she picked up Ladies' Home Journal. And that November, they had printed in Flanders Fields, even though it had already been out 3 years, they printed it, and she read it and liked the artwork with it. And she said, why aren't we doing something about this? Because they're talking about this torch. And she thought, well, you know what? Like, the poppies were in the illustration. And she thought, I'm going to go find some poppies. So on a break at this meeting, she went out into the sewing district of New York City. And she was getting very frustrated. She could only find a handful of silk poppies. And she thought, there's got to be another way of doing that. When she took these poppies back to the meeting, all the people at the meeting wanted to buy them from her and then donate the money. And that's how this all got started. So when she went home from that meeting, she started getting people to make poppies. And then it just exploded from there. But this is 2 days before November 11th of 1918. So that's how it all began in the United States, is she read that poem in Ladies' Home Journal. Again, Ladies' Home Journal, they're putting all this in. You recognize this one, that's U.S. poppy. Actually, that one is from the 50s. I remember in the early 60s, they still had that. I would help my mom and dad with the poppy donations. And so that's like that lacquered cardboard. We used to like to sit in the car and pick off all the little green nibby parts off the center, and my father would yell because it was all over the back seat of the car, but that's okay. Another one from the 60s with the paper. This is what the Canadians wear for their poppy. It's like a flocked plastic with a loose piece of black in the middle, and you poke yourself on the pin all the time. And this is one of the original Hague poppies. This is silk, and it has like silk black threads. A lot of the original poppies were made by French widows. France was left with, and Britain, no one to marry. It's the lost generation. And if you watch English movies, which were Downton Abbey when they were doing the First World War episodes, there are lots of people, women, in the British films called Auntie so-and-so. These aunts were because there were no men to marry. So families would adopt single women neighbors and call them auntie and bring them into, so they would be part of a family with small children. Lots of times they became kind of nannies to new babies, but there's a whole generation of aunts that have no blood relationship. It's only because there are no men left to marry, especially in France. After the Great War, again, we have children involved. We have Sousa's March. Again, this is a children's book, and you see, once again, you get that marking, the flag, super patriotism, the first Armistice Day. We have rebuilding. There's that Ypres cloth hall rebuilt the first time, and how people are so excited that it is rebuilt, because there's the famous postcards of the cloth hall, medieval cloth hall, on fire during the war. So it was rebuilt. So that hit the papers and magazines for your family. Remembrance. I have done a book on the unknown soldier around the world. I, I know about, as you do, our soldiers' memorial in Arlington National Cemetery, and we have Westminster Abbey with the unknown soldier. We have the Arc de Triomphe, the unknown soldier for France is underneath the Arc. But I wondered about how many other countries of the world had tombs of the unknown soldier, simply because even with Alexis Helmer, they knew where he was buried. He was buried, McCrae, they put the cross. But when the war continued all those years after, they start shelling the same places. And so that cemetery basically was shelled so much that they didn't know who was buried anywhere. And that's why he became one of the unknown graves. And his name is on Menin Gate in Ypres. But he did have a cross and he did have a grave. So when you get to the end of the war, how are you going to deal with a whole world that's in mourning? And that national governments figured out the way was to have one grave that represented all of the loss. There are incredible film footage, this incredible film footage of Italy. When they designated, they had different ways of designating. They had a mother who had lost a son, and she wore a black veil, and she went into the room with, I think it was seven caskets. They brought bodies from the battlefields. And then she went with her veil, and she just picked one of them and put her veil on it. And then that became the unknown soldier for Italy. And then they had the train trip to Rome to put that casket into a wall as a memorial. And when you see the film footage of the train trip, it's amazing because they have the casket on a flatbed car, and they kept stopping in villages, and they'd have a mass, they'd have a service, and people all believe it's possible it's their son or their husband. This great outpouring, the roar of grief, the throwing of flowers. You can hear the prayers, and then they'd move to another town, and then everyone shows up again because they think it could be their husband, their son. And this continued all the way into Rome. And then you see pictures. You can look online for any of this. You see the pictures of Rome on the day they bury their unknown. It's like a sea of people. And the same thing happened in every country because everyone wants to believe. I get goosebumps because when you think that the power of this could be your son, in all these countries of the world, and this was mostly done in the 1920s, ours is early 20s, the year after Britain and France. So that's what the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier did look like. In the same situation it has now, it was this plinth, and then we added to it. So the box form that we see now, and then we continued to add to it by putting the plaques in front of it for Korea and Vietnam. And I think you know that the Vietnam unknown soldier was identified as Michael Blassie, and so he was removed. And it was decreed that the U.S. will no longer have an unknown soldier. They're not going to continue with the process, partly because we have DNA identification now and chips identifying our military, so they would be able to identify. But that's what it looked like early on. Then in France, upstairs there's a gorgeous, good as new, French soldier's uniform. The original uniform was a blue jacket and red pants, which kind of, to the enemy, it's like, shoot, you know, red pants, can see you, not a problem. So they went to this gray or blue. They were called, it was called, the flower is called Le Bleuet, the cornflower of France, and that is worn by the French on November 11th in honor of their soldiers because of those blue uniforms. They also wear the poppy in France. They wear both. The same with Australia, wears the rosemary and the red poppy. This is a poppy, actually, nowadays from Scotland, different from the British, the English poppy. The English one would be just two parts that have paper. And these different statues. Now, these statues, different countries do different ways, but a lot of the statues, they would actually use a photograph of one of the boys lost from the town. And when they ordered the body, it was like a catalog. Your town actually got a catalog, and you could pick your base, And you could pick your soldier, like, is he going to be here with the rifle at rest? Is he going to be like this? Is he going to be jumping out, like, over the top? You could pick your stance. You could pick what the wreath was going to be like when you got it. You could pick your material. If you had a lot of money, it would be bronze. If you didn't have so much, it could be a kind of stone. If you really didn't have a lot of money in your community, they were poured concrete, which is the worst, the quickest to deteriorate, but those are gone. And some lucky person sometimes would have their son's face chiseled into the statue. And again, sometimes kids don't know, like when you have this kind of monument, this one in London, the cenotaph in London, that means there's a body. There's no body. When you have this kind of monument, it means it's representing the dead. It's not because there's someone actually buried there, which there is someone buried there. This actually was first made of cardboard and plywood. When the war ended and the king wanted to do his presentation in honor of them, this was made temporary. But they couldn't believe how many people showed up for that anniversary. And they said, I think we better make something permanent. And that's why when you visit London in Whitehall, there is the permanent one that's there, famous architect. And here we are 100 years later. In Flanders Fields also brought about what they called reply or response poems. And here's one of America's Answer, which was written by R.W. Lillard. And everyone, even Melina Michaels, she wrote a response poem to In Flanders Fields. In other words, people felt so moved by the poem that then they would say, don't worry about it, we'll pick up the torch, we're going to do it, here's what we're going to do. And then they would write, because poetry in those days is something lots of people do in their free time. Amateur poets or women would write and send it to the women's magazines, newspapers of the time. The public wrote poetry and there would be a section of the paper where they would include your poems or sometimes kids' drawings. This is McCrae's original grave. He died in January of 1918. He was asthmatic all his life. That winter, pneumonia, December 17 into winter 18, pneumonia was decimating the troops. He got pneumonia, which became meningitis. In only 3 days, he was dead. He had just been named the consulting surgeon for the whole of the British Army 3 days before his death. So, height of his career, 45 years old. I will tell you from everything I've read, he was horribly suffering post-traumatic stress disorder. His hair had gone white. He wasn't responding to people. He had been a master storyteller and jokester. He was not reacting normally. As I told you, the group on Thursday night, on one specific day, he treated 700 soldiers. And he was there from the beginning of the war till he died in January 18. He did have leaves, but people even would mention, like, I saw Jack McCrae in London. He was picking up supplies, and he barely talked. So to think he would come home, people always like to know things like, oh, what if, do you think he would have gone back to McGill and taught medical students? I think he probably would have gone back to Guelph, Ontario, and lived with his parents. I don't think it was in him anymore to continue in this life of service, even in the medical profession. His first grave was the wooden cross you see here. He's still buried in the exact same place, only now the stones are been replaced by the white stones. In this cemetery, they're all flat and flush to the ground because this is along the English Channel in France, and the wind is terrific on the top of that property, and it's also sandy soil, so none of those stones can remain erect, and so they don't fight Mother Nature. They're all flat for all of the soldiers in that cemetery. And this is a huge first. On May 3rd, this statue was unveiled in Ottawa near the Canadian War Museum. For 100 years, there has never been a statue of John McCrae in Canada, I think much to the shame of the country. To have, there are statues to him and plaques and everything all around the world, but other than his birthplace honoring him, he hasn't been honored by the government. So this was a real big deal when this was unveiled. It's larger than life. There's going to be what's nice about it is it's a woman, a Native American woman who designed it, Ruth Abernethy, and she's even got the bronze, so it's colored with red, the flowers down here. These were just put in around it, similar to what you have under the bridge. But this was unveiling day. A duplicate of the statue is going to be unveiled next month in Guelph, exact duplicate. So I've been on a committee for 2 years for working towards that day, so I'm really looking forward to next month for the great unveiling right near where he lived, right in his hometown. I'll leave you with that. I have a last picture of, if you've been to the European cemeteries, this is the cemetery at Tiepval, which has about a 50 to 60 mile view from that point. That was all battlefield. Most of when you go through France and Belgium, that's what you know, was all battlefield. This has French and British in this cemetery, so the French have the crosses and the British have the white stones. And there's your mix of cornflower. Another reason why it's picked, it seeds itself, and the poppies, and that's in France. And I'll stop there and see if anyone has any questions, or if the Thursday Nighters want me to. Thank you.
Linda, thank you so much. And we do have microphones that are set up on either side here if you have a question for Linda, or I can come over with this microphone.
Stairs. With the stairs, it's good to. Excuse me, speaking of a bottle. Hi.
One of the points I was really interested in was the response poem. And when you showed that slide, it just was labeled America's Answer.
Mm-hmm.
Is that the title of the poem?
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't catch the author's name of that and the recency of it.
Okay, it was done right after the poem came out, and I know it's a bit blurry there. It's R.W. Lillard, L-I-L-L, is it I-A-R-D?
Okay, R.W. Lillard, and that America's Answer was written.
If you just Google America's Answer, it'll come up.
Okay, thank you.
All right, and it's not the only response poem. There were lots of them. The poem's been translated all around the world. In fact, on the weekend of May 3rd, this was really interesting. Over in Australia, there was a special project, and they actually spent May 3rd and translated in Flanders Fields into languages that didn't already have it. And one of the languages was Maori, the Aboriginal language of New Zealand. And so someone in Mandarin, about 8 different languages for the first time it was put into those languages. And so the birthplace was like all excited, the curator there, because this is terrific that it's shared more and more around the world to the point where you have to have new translations. And also last month, after all these years, his work as a pathologist, he was recognized by the Canadian Medical Hall of Fame, and he was inducted into the, and two of his great nephews were at the table with us for this induction. So to hear their stories of how Uncle Jack, Great Uncle Jack, was talked about in his family was really interesting. Another question? Someone else? Observation? Okay, we have someone here. I could maybe hear you. I'll repeat your question if I.
I was just wondering if anybody ever tried to put together a book of the response.
Not that I know of. It's a good question. Had anyone ever tried to put together all the response poetry? That would take a lot of doing. You would have to go through loads of newspapers in all the cities because people were just so touched by it. They would have written thousands, I would guess, thousands of these when they would appear, like maybe Kansas City, some the paper would have had one, and the search for that would be amazing. But it's a good project. If you have a lot of free time, this is a good project. Another question, yes, sir.
Yeah, ma'am. I hope I'm not taking you too far away from your expertise.
If I don't know, I'll tell you.
Okay. I have heard it said that today's society or the world situation today is far more. World War I is far more relevant to what the problems we face today or the dangers we face today that got us into World War I are more relevant today than say World War II is.
Mm-hmm.
again, this is more high politics than your lecture is, and mm-hmm. if I'm pulling you too far away, I apologize, but mm-hmm. I am, you know, very, be interested to hear your views, if you believe that's true. I happen to believe it's true, for whatever that little that's worth.
A lot of people, yeah.
But anyway, do you believe that's the case, that our world situation today is much more relevant to World War I than to World War II?
In certain respects, and I'm not, you know, fighting around your question. In certain respects, I agree with you that, well, especially what happened with Afghanistan. The Afghanistan book that Laura mentioned, I did that because I was watching the news and realizing that a lot of the injuries we saw coming back from Afghanistan were similar to the injuries from the First World War, which means a lot of missing limbs. And then you're expected to carry on and pick up with your life. And that's what first got me thinking about the similarities between the two, what's going on now and what was going on then. Of course, as the saying is, the hindsight, the way we can look back and synthesize all this world history in this museum in that film that you first see about how we get into World War I, which is one of the best pieces of writing I've ever heard. That piece of film is just spectacular. It's hard to pinpoint, but it's like that bubbling up of things in different areas. I'd say that the difference from what you see now is religion. Because when you listen to that film up there, religion is not one of the aspects that's leading to the war, right? They're talking about the change in society, the royalty versus the everyman, the working and that. What we're hearing more now in problems around the world and where conflict is it's boiling down to faith. And that makes it another kind of war. So I think that's where the two are going to diverge. We're speaking personally here.
Right. Hopefully not going too much into high politics, but the impression I always get of World War I, we really stumbled into it. The leaders of the world just stumbled into it. In fact, one official says, how did we get into World War I? And he was a foreign minister of Germany. And he said, I don't have the slightest mm-hmm. idea how we got into it.
Well, it's war is emotion. It's emotion and like your heart and head, right? And like that does play a part in everything major in life.
Right.
I think that's what you're seeing in all that when you hear all of what you see in this museum, how much was emotion leading to decisions.
Right.
And you have to remember, too, they didn't even have the sharing of information the way we have now, even though our sharing of information can get skewed, right? Because we have propaganda at all times of our life, of history. You can go back to ancient Egypt and this propaganda making people think one thing or believe one thing. So the similarities, it's humanity. I was talking to someone earlier here in the audience where we were saying this whole thing of why do we keep fighting? Why do we still have wars? I've done a lot of interviewing of veterans of different wars, and one veteran of World War II, in his 90s, I said, Fred, you know, we were close friends. I said, Fred, I just some days, I don't know how you look back at what you did and your dad did in World War I, and like, what do you make of it? And he says, you know what? He says, we're always going to have wars because there's always somebody, someplace that wants what someone else has. Whether it's right or wrong or they have too little or you have more and I want that or I like what you have or whatever, that the basic human element is of greed, is of whatever, is always going to be there. And when you look back through, since we can look back at these things, you can see greed, like you hear it in the thing. Oh, so-and-so wants that piece of land. Oh, they're going to go take it. That's part of our problem, too, on bullies. This rise of discussion about bullies in the schoolyard and in your job place and all of that. It's like, as I was saying with this woman just now, kids are often made, and I find this in schools, I'll get introduced to a group of kids, and the teacher will say, and this, you understand how you can world peace. That's the worst thing to tell a kid. You're responsible. We messed up. They all messed up. It's up to you to fix it. No, like you can't, they cannot do it. the more reasonable approach would be, you can do your little part. You cannot have a fight at the dinner table every night with your sister, or you can watch out for bullying in the schoolyard, and that's your world, and that's your community, and you can take care of it right there. You can make the peace there, but this whole thing of, well, it's up to the young people now to take care of whatever comes up, doesn't work. Right. It's really unfair pressure on them, too. That's my personal thing.
The thing I want to, if I could, well, then I'll let you go. The one thing that I think also is the river flowing argument, that once something starts, it might not be evil. It might not be somebody who's trying to take somebody's land, although that's a big problem. Mm-hmm. But history has a way of just taking its own course, where mm-hmm. things start to roll. Because mm-hmm. I've seen that in personal conflicts, where you know, a burnt toast leads to a divorce, something like that.
Yeah.
one thing leads to another, leads to another, leads to another. And that seems to me that's what World War One was. It wasn't so much greed and evil, although that was a part of it. They just stumbled into it.
There's lots of theories. That's why that film is so good, because there are so many theories, there is not one. It's not just because Archduke Ferdinand driver took the wrong road that day. It's a whole lot of things. But thank you for your observations.
And we have time for just one more question. Is there anyone that I can come to with the microphone?
You have one? Go ahead. You maybe don't need a microphone. Go ahead. Oh, yeah, good question. Poppies do not need much soil to, you can basically scratch the ground, sprinkle seeds, scratch over it again, and they'll grow. So when you're in a fertile farmland that of the whole country, let's say France, and it gets pummeled, if you see aerial photographs, every square inch for miles is like a hole. All that soil is disturbed and ruined, but the poppies and the cornflowers don't need much soil to grow, so they would keep growing. And that was, you have a lot, I've seen so many diaries where people, near nurses or soldiers, pick those and like put them in, and they're like black now, but they survived. Because that was the bit of color around them in all this desolation. All those trees, that battlefield I went to, those trees have all regrown, but you've seen the images, like there's nothing left. You'd see like a shard of a tree where it's kind of exploded up like this, and they call those the flowers of the field, is what they called those trees. So total destruction, the mud, and that's why I said bacteria deaths, because this was farmland. Farmland is loaded with manure. You disrupt that, and you have like winter of rain, and you're standing with even like a cut in your leg, and the water all rises in the trench, and you're standing with the great coat that's sucking it all up, and that bacteria is just held, and you don't get out of that trench for maybe 2 weeks, and it's just festering. So a paper cut would have been enough to take your life, because that was farm field full of manure. So people tend to, you know, Hollywood has done a disservice in that, in its attempt to always show the heroics, it forgets that there are the other deaths, equally devastating to families, that was because of a paper cut in a trench. You know, it wasn't like in high battle where, who's the hero and who's, no. And that's the sad thing is, in World War II, the good thing is that the numbers of deaths from bacteria drop significantly, because by then, with penicillin.